Another beautiful Saturday morning, and thank you for joining us on the program Politics Today on Independent Television and Radio. My name is Sonny Duke Okosun, and it's also always a delight to bring you the program every Saturday. Today is not an exception, but as you already know, the biggest challenge confronting the nation today is a challenge of insecurity. Of course, we have a crack team of panelists. We have the former Deputy Speaker at the State House of Assembly, Festus Ebea, joining us via Zoom. And in a moment, you see him. Yes, we can hear you. We can hear you. Just be calm. We'll bring you on board. I also want to thank very specially Barrister Gentleman Amego and Barrister Steve Iyai, Barrister Greg Iyai. Thank you for joining us on the program.
Thank you.
Okay, well, a while ago you saw Festus Ebea joining us on the program. Now, the challenges are here and is a huge threat to Nigeria's stability. And for most analysts, what is needed at this time is to seek for foreign support, seek for foreign intervention. And in that direction, just on Tuesday, at a virtual meeting with the U.S. Secretary of State, General Blinken, of course, President Muhammadu Buhari requested for the relocation of the African command from Germany to Africa, particularly, yes, Africa. So the support needed to tackle the spate of insecurity can be gotten from the U.S., and we hope that comes into fruition. But while that has been looked into, we need to get something urgent going in checkmating the insecurity challenges bedeviling the country. As usual, our studio numbers will be open so you can call. You can follow me on my personal Twitter handle at Duke Okosun, on our ITV Twitter handle at ITV Radio NG. Post a comment there. We'll share it on the program. Okay, let me quickly get a panelist on board. Mr. Gentleman Amego, we follow this issue consistently in the last couple of years. And despite all efforts to tackle it head on, it looks like the end is not just in sight just yet. What do you make of this scenario that is playing out?
Thank you. Yeah. I didn't expect that we would discuss something else apart from insecurity, which has bedeviled this country since 2004. We have been in this mess since 2001. When it just came, people trivialized this. They said, oh, we're going to defeat them. We're going to defeat them. But here we are in 2021. We are still having the menace among us. Well, I think that the problem of insecurity is lack of commitment of those who govern us from the top to the bottom. This complete lack of sincerity. This governor of Ebonyi, Umuahi, he told us a few weeks ago that what happens in this country is that they themselves who are leaders are not honest. He said they have something, they think of something and they don't do it. So you are deceiving us, that's what it means. You see, Duke, in my house, I have a drone. Sometimes I put it in the air. It goes over 3 kilometers and it takes photographs. And it comes back. A friend came to see me and wanted to see what was happening in his room in Lagos. He put his telephone, I don't know what you are doing now. And he was seeing his room. He was seeing the house girl picking meat from the shoe. That's just an individual. He was saying, oh, look at this girl. So yeah, how it goes to steal meat from the soup. The area known and called Nigeria, the map is surveyed. The map is in Mr. President's office. They can punch it and see what is happening any part of the country.
So are you so sure that that exists as you speak?
It's
are you
supposed
so sure?
to exist. Yes. It doesn't cost so much to fix that. So he can sit down in his office and see what is happening in far away Yobe, far away Zamfara. He can see that from his room if he's committed. And he will send soldiers there or send policemen there. Go to kilometer XSS in
But is that supposed to be the responsibility of the president? I mean, why do you have service chiefs, as it were?
When the center cannot hold,
yes,
things will fall apart. Mm. It is Mr. President who will direct XYZ. Direct you to do this, do that. That is the meaning of leadership.
Okay.
If we have no person to lead us, to tell us what to do. Then, of course, we don't have a leader. So there are things that they should, even in Benin. See what is happening now. America just mentioned 20 states that are insecure in Nigeria. We thank God, we thank our governor. Our state is not one of the states.
Yeah.
because of commitment. The governor here is not in my party, but he's doing very well, excellently well. He is committed to securing the lives and properties of Edo State. Have you, for some time, you know, be hearing popo, popo at night. These boys are all in the street, they are securing us, for which we are very grateful. There are so many states who do not sleep.
If with their two eyes closed.
Yeah, they can't. I'm in sympathy with them. They kill soldiers, they kill policemen, they kill all sorts of people.
Okay, let me pause you there. I've got Festus Ebeya joining us now. We hope you'll be able to reconnect with us via Zoom, but he's on telephone. Festus, thank you for joining us on the program Politics Today. Now, the challenge of insecurity has become a monster that just won't go away. Just when you think that efforts have been made to checkmate it, it resurfaces in a different form, in a different style, in a different way, and sometimes in states that you probably would think that maybe they are secured relatively. What do you make of the seeming incapacity to deal with this issue head on?
What we are facing today as insecurity has no religious or tribal coloration. But the government is unable to deal with it because they themselves, they have taken position either as an entity or as an entity class.
Okay, but there's, Professor, there's no evidence to
indicate that government is backing those who are perpetrating this evil, because no sane government, no sensible government will do that. Maybe because of the way the issues have gone for such a long time, it may look as if maybe government is not, the efforts government is making is not producing the needed result. But I'm sure that as we get along with all the meetings, interactions, and support that is being sought, we certainly will get to the root of this, and it will be drastically reduced in the days to come. But I just want to ask you to pause for a moment and just stay on. I'll reconnect with you again in the next few minutes just to get your views on seeking support, actually, to end the challenge of insecurity in Nigeria. Would you do that? And if you can reconnect with us again via Zoom, I really would appreciate that. But in any case, just try and be on standby. I'll get back to you in a moment. Let me come to Barrister Yayi. Where we are today is a precarious situation, not insurmountable. Not insurmountable. People have talked about political will. Is this really the absence of political will that has taken us to where we are today, or there are other factors?
I think the greatest factor is the political will. Because if the political will is there, it will bring out the best in our security agencies. Because you imagine a situation where, as things are now, sometimes some of our security men are not paid. Soldiers at the front line, at the battlefront, is demoralizing. How do you expect that? So they can even decide to sabotage the effort of the government. These are things you should look at. Look at where they live. Then look at the superior firepower of the insurgents and the bandits. How do you face somebody with a knife who is holding an AK-47? So they are ill-equipped. And I think these are things, if the government is saying we are fighting security, these are things they should look at. Because you don't just send soldiers to the battleground just to make it a slaughter ground for them. It shouldn't be. They are people's husbands, they are people's children, and so on. So the government should adequately equip them. I believe that Nigeria has well-trained army. And if they are well-equipped, if they are motivated, that they can do the best. And then government should be very proactive in taking decisions, because some of the people in the intelligence community, they generate very credible intelligence. But you see, they can only generate, they cannot consume. If they generate the intelligence, it's left for the government to consume it. Mm. And because there have been occasions where the intelligence community will give report that there's going to be an attack.
Yeah.
The government is supposed to be proactive. And then the government waits till the attack happens before they mobilize forces to go there. These are the reasons some people are saying that there's really no political will to do so. Then I know within the forces, there are fifth columnists. The government should identify them and deal with them. Because if the fifth columnists are working with you, no matter your efforts, they are going to sabotage you, they are going to grind all your plans, and you won't achieve anything. These are things I feel the government should look at, the political will, and then identify the fifth columnists among them.
Okay, Mr. Mego, there have been calls for the declaration of state of emergency. How far do you think that can help to salvage the situation?
It definitely will, at least it will reduce the tension we are in right now. Emergency means everybody take care of yourself. Even those civilians who are not involved, take care of yourself. We are in emergency. They themselves who are in the bush, these faceless people who come out to kill others, they will arrange themselves that look, we are in a state of emergency. That's why it comes in. But thank God that a stakeholder meeting has been called for Tuesday, as directed by Mr. President. This is what we have been asking for. Let me all come together and discuss. Cross-pollinate ideas and let everybody say this is where we should go. Because the situation we are now is removing so many things from Nigeria. So many things that normally should come to Nigeria are now going to Ghana and some other African countries. Like I said, it's the political will. We need it. We need somebody died as a president going to war front to see what was happening, even though he already overstayed in power for 30 years. But what was the president doing? The question is, what was that president doing in front line? But he wanted to satisfy his people. The other man of Tanzania also said there was no COVID and he died of COVID. You see, these people were leaders who committed themselves. They must be your transparent commitment to securing us. It's a very serious matter. So when they meet on Tuesday, we'll see what comes out of it.
Okay.
Like I was saying, sir.
Yes.
It is very easy. Sabisa Forest, is it not in Nigeria?
Yes.
It's in Nigeria. We have the map of Sabisa Forest. Mm-hmm. Where are they hiding Sabisa Forest? We cannot see them. Where? All right. In what do you call it? Kwara State. They took all these, Niger State took all the students. Where are they in the forest? If it's the those states, we go to Okomu. Where are the forest? We go to Precious, what do you call it? The other one?
Presco.
That we go to Presco. These are the forest. There are no other forest. We go to Auchi. That is Savannah. We can easily see where they are hiding. But there must be commitment to get these people out. Although I know it's a difficulty because they are faceless people. At night, you are sleeping, they come out, they shoot, run back into the forest. That forest is Nigeria. That's what I'm saying.
Yeah. You're saying we need to involve more of technology?
Yes, precisely.
Okay.
We don't need America to come and help us solve this problem.
Okay. So I'll come back to that point, come to you on that point. Let me get Festus Ebeah. He's been standing by on Zoom just to contribute to this discussion. Hello, Festus. Thank you for joining us again on the program. Now, the major talking point in the last couple of days is the need for Nigeria to seek help from world powers, the US, NATO, Europe, Britain, and the rest of them, against the background of the seeming overwhelming insecurity situation in the country. How germane is this? How realistic is this? Do you think this kind of help we go in a long way to change the security situation in Nigeria?
It's very germane, Joko Kosu. Very, very germane. We should stop pretending by saying that we don't need outside help. When we went to ECOWAS, were we not able to bring solutions to Liberia and Sierra Leone? If we don't get foreign help, people who are supplying arms to the militants or to the bandits here, they are not just Nigerians. People within the same international community, they first of all, they manufacture the guns. If they really want to trace those arms that are today in the West African sub-region, principally Nigeria, they can trace from the manufacturers. Through the manufacturers, they can equally trace those who bought the guns. So if we say we don't need international community to help us, we are just making a very big mistake. It's very germane that we need them to come in, first of all, cut off supply of these arms, and equally go after those who are sponsoring them from us, whether for business interests or whatever. You are talking about ISIS. ISIS is not important in Nigeria. If you talk about Al-Qaeda, it's not important in Nigeria. The Israel you are talking about is not mainly in Nigeria, and you are talking about West Africa. So we need people within the outside to help us to police them. I tell you something. Draft is a game of the people. But the onlookers, they always see the loopholes. If you allow the international community or international forces, whether from America, Britain, or even EU or whatever you call them, who are well equipped technologically and all that, they can cut off the supply of these arms and ammunition and equally make it impossible because they are not fighting with bare hands. Once they don't have the means or an attempt to force themselves to get it, you begin to arrest those who are perpetrating the civil. So whether we like it or not, the only way out now that we have tried our own people internally, we are not able to deal with it. Instead of allowing Nigerians to dying like chickens every minute a day, we need outside help.
Does it also make meaning, because people are talking about the need for us to declare a state of emergency in dealing with this insecurity? But I think it's the governor of Katsina State who said a state of emergency will not be needed because the security forces are already overstretched. And declaring a state of emergency will put more pressure and tension on the overstressed security situation. Do you subscribe to this line of reasoning?
State of emergency is just a phrase. For me, I don't are stretching those who are already fighting it, then we are here, we are not ready. Like I said before, if a state of emergency location is bringing in of the Americans and those who know how to fight this, better for us. But don't just say state of emergency because you want to make a statement. I do not think that the state of emergency is what we talk about. We should talk about commitment to allow those who are well equipped to deal with this kind of guerrilla warfare to come into it. From what we can see, our army, they've done their best within the limit of their power. But we cannot, because of that, pretending that we can deal with it, what people are dying every day. So, state of emergency, if it's going to bring solution, for me, it is just a mere statement. They have not told us, those who are proposing for state of emergency, they have not told us what it entails to bring the state, to call a state of emergency. If it's to fast track the process, so be it. But if it's just to begin to think how everybody will now plan to stand the forest, how many, first of all, how many men do we have to even fight people we're talking about? We're talking about the whole country. No area is safe in Nigeria. No area is safe. I do not think the strength of the army we have can deal with it. So we should stop pretending.
Okay. Okay, let's just respond to you. Let's pause you there. Let's just pause you there for a moment. I'll get back to you. I'll get back to you now. A major narrative that has come forth in this discussion is that when there is a demand,
yes,
then there is a supply.
Yes.
And once there is a ready supply, then you can rest assured that there is sustainability. That seems to be why this war is a war, whether we like it or not.
Yes.
It's a war situation that
yes,
we have.
Yes, yes.
That's why this situation has persisted
yes.
for such a long time.
And dealers and so on.
Yes, so let me get your perspective along yes. those lines.
Yes, I think this might be the mischief makers on that ground who might be wanting to sustain the state of insecurity.
Okay.
But I believe the government has the power to break whatever. The government can break their will. I mean, they are businessmen. They want ammunition. And some of them are mercenary fighters. They want to come in and then they get contracts to fight. But the government can decide that this place cannot be the theater of war.
Mm.
And that you cannot be doing profitable business at the expense of the blood of my people.
Okay.
This is exactly what we are asking the government to do. If you want to bring in the Americans or whoever to help us in the area of technology, in the area of weaponry, in the area of logistics, there's no problem about that. But when they finish the battle, we are the ones that will keep the peace.
Mm.
We are the ones that will maintain the peace. And we must be ready to do that. And let me say one other thing that is often not mentioned, that is a major factor in this insecurity, and is one of the issues which have been taken up in our NBA meeting. In our NBA conference, that's our major topic for the NBA conference. It is the issue of injustice in the land. When there is injustice, things like this will happen. These things are solvable, very solvable.
Are you saying those who
yes.
are, you know, involving in banditry is because of injustice meted against them?
Yes. You see, some of the, how did Boko Haram begin? Boko Haram began because there was no rule of law. Somebody was arrested, the leader, Yusuf. And he was handed over by the army to the police. Instead of charging him to court, you decided to do extrajudicial execution. Then Boko Haram members took up arms. Look at the case of El Zaki. How many courts, even the ECOWAS court has said, grant this man bail. But bail has not been given to him. These are the problems.
Even because the conditions of bail have not been met.
Yeah, the
yes,
conditions
and then
of bail.
Of course, you have
they
multiple
are iron,
cases.
Iron conditions.
There are multiple cases
yes.
at the federal and at the state.
Yes.
When he gets through with the state conditions, and then he's waiting for the federal condition, as it were.
Deliberately created as obstacles.
Well, you cannot say they are deliberate. They were created based on the circumstances prevailing.
But that is also
yes.
one of the things. What led to it?
is injustice. That's the point you're making.
Yes.
All right, let me get Vice Tamego in here. Yeah.
But all these stories of injustice. Is that why a tribe to gather together and go out killing people? Is that the reason for the injustice? Is that the injustice we are talking about? This thing didn't start in Nigeria. It was in another African country. Well, it came because people didn't like, well, allegedly that they didn't like Jonathan. They were going to make Jonathan's administration ungovernable. That was how we knew these people. We didn't know them before. The Boko Haram were just in Yobe and Adamawa. We didn't know on Borno. Then suddenly they started spreading. These are nomadic people who live in the forest. I still have a very strong belief that if we have a strong will, political will, we can deal with these people. Just like some states now are dealing with the insecurity. The America we're talking about just mentioned 20 states where they have high insecurity. Thank God that they do is not one of them. There are other 16 states. There are other 16 states who they say, well, you can visit those states.
Yeah.
It is because those responsible, they have done something. They have worked. We have been talking of state police. Nobody is listening to us. Now they have a community police. They are effective. So let them bring their heads together on Tuesday and tell us what they want us to do. You see, I still maintain we are at war. I accept that. Nigerian soldiers are very strong soldiers. We have been going to so many places to fight wars. If there is commitment, our soldiers will deal with this situation. Unless, of course, they say, okay, go there, arrest Duke, don't arrest Peter. That's where we are trying to find out. Are there people? I don't believe the fifth columnist, because I want to know what do they want to achieve. The bandits, the Boko Haram, ask them, what exactly do you want? They are bereft. They don't know what to tell you that they want. Just because come and take money, come and fight in the bush. In the process, you also lose your life. Those are people who have no respect for life. It's very unfortunate. How did we get here? Some people came from nowhere. Probably, what is everybody is talking? Sorry, let me not miss this point. Everybody talking of job.
Unemployment.
Where is unemployment? Where in this world, the whole world, where government is the only sole employer of the employee? Where in the whole world? These individuals. Today we are complaining. Go to Maza. People have on pineapple farm. They are building houses in Benin. We have the land. We have the human beings. But everybody is talking of government. The number of people employed in government is not up to 3% of our population. Why are we still saying government? Where are the industries to fix? They just employ them. Where do you keep them to work? If you don't have a job, please create a job for yourself.
Good job. All right. Festus, let me thank you again for staying with us on the program Politics Today. I wanted to find out from you what you make of the complaints that have been coming from some state chief executives, notably the governor of Niger State. In an interview he granted the press recently, alleged that Boko Haram were already in the state, and that they hoisted their flag in one of the local governments.
Yes.
We also heard from the member representing one of the constituencies in that state saying on the floor of the house that three local governments are already being threatened by Boko Haram. And the governor said he has been saying that there were threats, there were reports that these guys were advancing.
Yes.
In the last comment he made that these guys are just about 2 hours from the federal capital territory. That's on the one hand. And then we also heard the account of the governor of Enugu State,
yes,
Ogwain, saying that when there was a report of a possible attack, he made frantic effort to reach the authorities in charge. He was kept on the waiting line on the phone for an hour, and eventually, after about 4 hours, when the response came, it was too late. He reached out to the GOC in the state, he reached out to the Commissioner of Police. They said, well, he should reach out to the presidency to get a director. Eventually, before all those responses came, the damage had been done. Now, what do you make of this? I've heard people say, look, the state governors are the chief security officers of their state.
They are not.
They should stop bothering the presidency. They should fix the problem. I don't know what you make of this.
Unfortunately, agree that the governors, they are limited in terms of their chief security, head of chief security of their respective states. There is a limit to the extent that they cannot really direct the police or the army as it is, which I think is one quality cost to power support. However, I am restrained from commenting on the, especially when you mentioned the Enugu, I never heard of the Niger. When you talk about the Enugu, when I saw that on social media, I only saw where they said it was a lie. You understand? In as much as there's insecurity in Nigeria, most of the things being created, they are non-existent. In the last 2 days, I've been seeing where they say, look at Boko Haram entry, they were shooting, it was an open field. You understand? Later, I only saw the video, they say, look at where they were entering the jail report. So I don't know which one to believe. However, the state governors should not look for excuses, not to even act. What am I saying is, in my state, I know how much goes into the coffers or that goes into the hand of the state governor as security vote. 10% of that can actually tackle some of the problems we are talking about. Why am I saying that? The state governor that collects as much as 500, 700 million in a month cannot equip, even if it's ordinary vigilante. Going to Ishana from Benin, one of the local governments on the road, they admit it. That at least you see at every point, about 3 or 4 points before Ode people, they have been able to put vigilantes on the road at strategic locations, even with their single barrel. Governors can do this. And I tell you, the people we are talking about, they are human beings. They equally know that some of them can be spotted. They don't just live in the bush and buy the guns in the bush. They come to the town to do that. Having people who are either undercover agents or even ex-military or spy chiefs to be within the area where all these things can be got is not beyond the governors to do. My own point I'm making, cut the supply to these people.
If you know it,
cut
you know
the supply. When we talked about international community, we are not saying that when they come, we are going to see them and the ones who are now at the borders fighting all these things. That intelligence that we don't have. I tell you something. You, when Tony Jonas said I have Boko Haram in my government, people didn't understand. Even the present administration were in, they only have Boko Haram in their government, in the government. Likewise, in the states. There are people who are sympathetic to these causes, some of them for altruistic reasons. You see, most of us Nigerians, how we make money is not even, it doesn't concern us so long as we make the money. Some people are funding this business for economic reasons. If you cut the supply, you won't be talking about every time you want to drag the federal mind to come at me for sharing 37 state governors, 36 state governors in Abuja. The governors themselves, they have enough means for the core security. There's no governor in Nigeria that takes anything less than 300 million every month. Just want to deal with a local government. 1 month more just to deal with a local government. Going to Asia alone, you have all you want there and for part of East and West along there. Are you saying that 300 million or even the 500, 600 million that is coming to a state government, they cannot deal with the security along that axis? I came from Lagos yesterday. As it is now, I counted over 30 checkpoints. If for nothing, I mean, it sends that fear that you cannot just be operating without molestation. I'm talking about the one that concerns us here within our South region, not the Sambisa Forest. I heard when somebody was speaking, this gentleman, he talked about Sambisa Forest. Is Sambisa Forest a cosmic land? Never land, we don't know. Is it a fairy tale? The governors themselves within that region, they are not doing enough. It's not everything you keep calling the federal presence. The money you have, use it to equip the local vigilantes, because these human beings, these people who are fighting Boko Haram, who are calling themselves Boko Haram, they are human beings. Even if they live in that bush, somebody owns the land. And in this meeting, if they enter any land and build a farm, somebody will come and say, this is my land. We have not been able to deal with each community, bring them into the security network. You will see the difference.
Okay. All right.
So there's no strong need to push it back to governance, because the governors are not doing enough.
Okay, let me pursue the first. I'll be right back with you to get more from you. It's still politics today.
Let me quickly respond to a point that he raised.
Yes.
That the governors can actually take care of that one with due respect.
Mm.
It is only to an extent. For instance, if I have the money to buy ammunition to arm people,
yes,
and I do not have the authority to purchase.
You are limited. You are limited by that.
You are limited because, well, they can purchase double barrels, but can they purchase AK-47? They cannot. And even the licensing of that double barrel is in the hands of the police. The police is not state. What the Constitution says, and we should be aware, he has been the former speaker or deputy speaker of the House. He knows the limitation. Constitutional limitation of the powers of a governor. Do you know a commissioner of police can disobey a governor? He is asked to take lawful orders from the governor. Who decides what is lawful and what is not lawful? And then what if there is conflict? He is asked to defer to the police authorities and not the political leadership of the state headed by the governor.
Mm.
So these are some of the constitutional limitations, and these are areas we have been saying should be revisited.
Okay.
The governor is the chief security officer of the state. Chief security officer of the state. Can the governor give orders to a GOC commander? He cannot. Like what we were told, when he communicated with the GOC commander, he was told, get in touch with the presidency. The presidency will order, because the army is under the federal government. So these are the limitations of the governors. And we should be realistic. The governors, some of them have the will, the political will. Some of them are not happy their people have been slaughtered. But what if they are hamstrung by constitutional limitations? For instance, Jonathan wanted to buy some ammunition from the American government. We had the money. America said we are not selling. They wanted to buy from South Africa. They seized the cash and they played. So these are some of the problems. The governors, yes, they may have the money. They may want to purchase. But what if they are not allowed to do so?
Okay, so
Duke. Doesn't it surprise you that there's an airstrip in this country not known by federal government, where a plane can come down and take off? I think it's in Niger State or...
But there was a story that came up to say that it was not true, that video was a video in one of these South American country where they were using that airstrip for drugs. The drug lords were using that airstrip,
yes,
you know, to carry out the operations. They use it to carry drugs. They use it to carry arms. So there are a whole lot of things that are happening with all of these issues that is mind. But the point I wanted to I wanted to raise is the fact that there seems to be pressure on the governors. If we're saying that constitutionally the governors are limited, but can't they make much of investment in intelligence gathering, which is part of the new strategy for tackling security? Because it's better to be active or reactive.
Yes, yes.
I mean, it's better to be proactive, than being reactive.
Yes.
Yes.
Now, if the governors are able to do that, like what I've said, intelligence gathering has never been the problem of the Nigerian security agencies. To be frank, we have very sprout, very good intelligence men in our intelligence community. But what if they gather the intelligence? The consumption of the intelligence is the issue.
Okay.
Like the Enugu State Governor, good intelligence was gathered, but who consumes it?
Yeah.
No one. So this is where the problem is. So it falls back to the issue we have been happy on, that the federal government must have the political will.
Okay, yes.
Yeah, but are we saying, except you want to educate me on this, that the governors don't have direct line to Mr. President? If there is problem, mistake, can't he report straight to Mr. President or to Mr. Vice President?
Yeah, but you heard the Enugu State case where he said he made efforts to reach out to Mr. President or to the presidency.
Yeah.
He didn't get response until about 4 hours later. Then, within that period, the attacks are taking place at in two communities, and people have lost their lives.
Yes, but
we heard on Professor Sebea saying just now, well, he also saw on social media that story wasn't true. So one doesn't even know what to believe anymore. But the fact remains that people are being killed, lives are being lost, properties are being destroyed, and there needs to be a decisive action to deal with this issue. Let me come back to you, Festus.
Autumn reported.
Yes.
Mr. President is replying by saying, Autumn.
Yes.
You like to talk about people. Can't you talk about yourself?
Yes.
Just childlike reply.
Yes, yes. Let me come back to you, because you seem to have a strong view that the governors need to take more decisive action in dealing with this issue, exactly from the perspective that they have access to security vote, which nobody can really question, because it's provided for by the Constitution.
Exactly.
But do you also realize, do you also appreciate the fact that these governors are limited based on the provisions of the Constitution as to the extent to which they can do? How do you think we can deal with that limitation to remove that those encumbrances for the governors to be able to take charge of their state? Because I remember one of the governors once said that on no account should anybody call him the chief security advisor, I mean the chief security officer of his state, because he has no control over the police, the army, the security. He doesn't have control over. I think it was Katsina State, the former governor of Katsina State, who made that statement. So what do you make of this, Festus?
Exactly. Exactly. We don't know.
Tell me what they discussed.
Say it, please.
Their respective states, and they should close it down. You say the governors of Nigeria, they are too powerful to be lamenting in public. The executive powers given to them is so strong that they should stop lamenting. If the 36 state governors across party lines, they should sink their political differences and have a united voice and go to Mr. President. All these complaints, I call them complaints, because they are mere excuses. They are not reasons why they are not acting. They are mere excuses. If they go to Mr. President and the state governors, and they are not talking about party, say this is our predicament. We are being hamstrung for this, for that, for good constitutional reasons and all that. Look, my brother, NDK the best says, yes, men have learned to shoot without missing. Does boy learn how to fly without pitching? How come every law in Nigeria, whether it is money laundry, whether it is any form of 419, they always look for a way to circumvent it? Are you saying the governors don't know how to circumvent the constitutional impediments? They know. You understand? They keep doing governors for, and they go to National Council of State meetings. Do you hear them talking? When they get there, they keep quiet, they come out, they start giving us excuses. The governors, in terms of internal security, they are not doing enough. They are not doing enough. All they are looking for is to be shifting blame. Oh, it's a president. Before you know it becomes a partisan issue. So because this person is not from the government, the president's party, or this one is from this. Look, tell them to sit down. The most they are collecting, they call security votes. They should use them. They should use that money to fight the cause. One of the panelists there re-echoed what I said before. Intelligence gathering is number one step. Let me remind you, when they said some BDC operators were arrested in Dubai for being found with money, which of course again was linked to Boko Haram and all that.
Yeah.
Was it an intelligence gathering that got it?
Okay.
It's from this international community. Until recently, out of shame, the government now came and started calling that Combino, Rudy Change, and some other people who were involved in the trafficking of money to fund the operations of Boko Haram and other insurgencies. So what I'm telling you, We are only being reactive. We are not proactive. We keep waiting for the thing to happen. Like I said before, the governor of Enugu State, how come we only read it on social media? We have allowed social media to be dictating the pace of what is to be. Only this morning I saw SSS issuing statement that one is saying that they are moving sea grenade or whatever down to the south. It's near DSN or so. It's not true. And DSN, of course, had the calling command to say it's not true. But we read all these things in social media. Before you know it, our traditional media begin to kill. So we don't really know what to believe.
Okay.
The governor should wake up and pursue all these issues we are talking about.
Okay. Let's take a break from you now.
Intelligence properly and take it to the appropriate authority.
All
if
right.
The appropriate authority is not going to handle it, look for an internal way to deal with it.
Okay.
That is the indicate the best way I'm telling you.
All right. Let's take a pause from you now. I'll be back with you to get a final word from you. Our studio number is 052-290-573. If you dial that number right now, you'll be able to contribute to the program Politics Today on independent television and radio. Tell us your name, where you're calling from. Be as brief as possible. As a matter of fact, you just have 2 minutes to make your point. So go straight to the point. Good morning, caller. What's your name and where you calling from? Good morning, caller. What's your name and where you calling from? Ola is calling us from Ore. Go ahead, Ola. Go ahead.
Okay. I think the governor, to be fair to them, they accuse them of many things. But when it comes to the issue of security, most of them are very, very much concerned. Like my state governor here, okay, the new when he saw the state of kidnapping and lots of criminal crimes happening, especially along the Akoko to Okini, Okene in Kogi State, he was forced to rally around all of that state governors in the South that they should come up with Operation Amateur. And we can see even the problem has not solved. So that shows you that some of them are passionate about security.
Okay.
But the issue we have is that we are not being sincere to one another. We know that this problem is persisting every day and that the state governors do not have absolute power over the security agencies around it. Why can't the lawmakers help us to come up with a bill for the creation of state police? We have known that this security architecture needs to be decentralized. And nobody is talking about it. Our senators and members are there talking about politics and all manners of things. But no thing that can remove the insecurity.
Yeah.
So not until that is done, that every state has command over his own police, then it is then that the insecurity will be eradicated. Thank you.
Ola, thank you very much for this perspective that you brought to bear in the conversation. We truly appreciate you. Hello, caller. Good morning. What's your name and where are you calling from? Good morning, caller. What's your name?
Hello.
Yes, good morning. What's your name?
Yeah, Andrew Ayala is the name. Andrew Ayala is the name.
Where are you calling us from?
I come from the
All right, go ahead.
Now, my concern is we don't seem to be pursuing this. One, we are told recently by news that people came all the way from Mali to Nigeria in Ogun State to demand for blocks and they kidnap people, take them to the bush. Can the military not go to the bush to surrender the people? Secondly, we're talking of unemployment. What has Nigeria got to do with Mali? What has Nigeria got to do with Chad and Niger? Who are flooding Nigeria? Why can't the government do something about this? The truth is that none of us want to understand. We know the truth, but we're not pursuing the truth.
Okay.
What we do is that we bury our head. The blood is a thing is caused. When the insecurity started, so no one was going on. They started in a very mindful. Now it has gone to an advanced stage. Every northerner is defending the God, the president, the action. Meanwhile, the president is silent. Look at what happened to the Enugu State Governor.
If you say the president is silent, you're not totally correct. I mean, you are aware there was a meeting yesterday, and then a stakeholders meeting has been called for Tuesday. You will not be absolutely correct to say the president is silent. Yes.
Organized men and let them had used the ESM to destroy those people.
Okay, all right. Let me pause you there, so we can give the opportunity to another person. Thank you. Okay, our studio number 052-290-573. You can also tweet at us at ITV Radio NG. Follow me on my personal Twitter handle at Duke Kosun and post a comment there. We'll share it on the program. Hello, caller. Good morning. What's your name and where you calling from? Good morning. Yes. Tell us your name and where you calling from. Where are you calling us from? All right, please turn down the audio level on your TV set or radio to remove the echo. Or better say, move backward. That's a good question you're asking, and want to thank you for joining us. Hello, caller. Good morning. What's your name and where are you calling from?
This is Chadwick. I'm calling from Oloko.
All right, Chadwick, go ahead, please.
Yes, the major problem, I think, is the new start today. You can recall the far back in 2001 where suicide bombing started. Then you recall the Arab Spring, you know, from like 5, 6, 7 years later. One thing about Nigeria is that as a country, we find it very difficult to look ahead, you know, for the future. I mean, there are certain things you can envisage militarily.
Yeah.
You can see their backwards, they can sit down and envisage certain situations.
Yeah.
And they try to counter and, you know, develop technologies, develop intelligence, and, you know, so that if at the time they are to experience such things, then they can be able to take cater for it. I mean, look at 2001 to this time. When we were watching the World Trade Center attack, Pentagon Hill, we just sat down, we didn't look at our geographic calculations, we didn't look at the map. Let me put this, it's very greatest, you understand, in the valley, you know, it happened just after, you know, the Arab Spring, it was coming closer, and at this time now, we are now envisaged with Boko Haram and everything. So we should stop being reactive, you know, and be proactive.
Okay, I'll pause it here because of time. Hello, caller. Good morning. What's your name? Just quickly make your contribution. Please turn down the audio level on your TV or radio. Good morning, caller. What's your name? Yes, good morning. Where are you calling us from?
Yes, my name is Daniel. I'm calling from Dubai.
Go ahead, Daniel. I'll be quick. But I've seen small potholes patched in recent times. Small potholes patched. Example.
That is sad.
Okay.
The major thing now is the security situation. It started so little, slowly. But I'm very sure there were times we neglected these things and we disregarded intelligence and continued to do what we were doing.
Okay.
The major thing the government needs to do now is to be honest with the facts and themselves and know that this is not business as usual.
Thank you. Thank you. Let me get final words from our panelists here. Brother Gentleman Amego, final words. Yeah.
What we saw recently, sir, that over the killing of George Floyd in America, Mr. President went to kneel down to a 4-year-old child to say, we are sorry for having killed your father. Here, 5 undergraduates have been killed. No high power delegation has gone to see members of the family. That's a nonchalant attitude. That they can die, they have right to die. At least that's commitment that we are talking about we are going to fish out those who are responsible. It will now energize our people.
Okay.
It will give hope to the hopeless.
Okay.
Not just say when people die, you don't show any concern.
Okay. So well, there are those who also disagree with you that even while these things are happening, government is reaching out to the families concerned, not like
behind the door,
not like they're not doing anything about it or showing remorse or showing concern. Okay, you want it visualized.
Yes.
All right, but I say, yeah, you won't watch from you.
I think the Federal Government should do more.
Okay.
And then take his place because the president, the commander in chief.
Okay. Okay, so Honorable Festus Ebea, I'd like to get your final word on proffering lasting solution in tackling insecurity in the country. What's your final take?
Let's be proactive. You understand?
Okay.
Let's be proactive. Information gathering is important. Intelligence gathering is important. Without intelligence, we're not going to have a well-harmonized approach to deal with this matter. And we don't need to wait until it has happened before we need to run around.
Okay. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Gentlemen, I want to thank you all for coming on the program. Festus Ebea, thank you. We appreciate you. Bryce Tahia, you thank you. Bryce Gentleman Amego, thank you. And you watching at home, thank you. Or listening at home, wherever you are in any part of the world, we truly appreciate you. That's our program for today on Politics Today on Independent Television and Radio. Insecurity problem is a problem that can be fixed if we all put our hands on deck. Report any suspicious movement in your environment, in your neighborhood. And we also pray that those who would take advantage of this information will not divulge this information. They will take it hook, line, and sinker and then use it decisively to checkmate the insecurity situation. The buck stops on the table of Mr. President. And in that regard, he needs to be more proactive in responding to these issues. Niger State Governor came up with a report that Boko Haram are now in about three states. He's been sending a report based on security report that he's getting. No meaningful action seems to have been taken until some people were displaced. We even hear that the report I got it recently that some of the communities are now negotiating with the militants for their safety and protection. That's certainly not a good omen for this country. But we're looking forward to the outcome of the stakeholders Security Council meeting on Tuesday with Mr. President. We hope that at the level it is now, where everyone is deeply concerned, even where senators are crying on the floor of the National Assembly, it shows to you how bad the situation is and needs urgent attention. Just 3 days ago, the senator representing my senatorial district, Senator Clifford Odia, narrowly escaped being killed. We thank God for his life. But everybody needs to realize that we must put in all efforts. The vigilante groups that we have in our communities, let's support them, let's assist them so that they be more effective and they can buy more equipment to be able to fortify whatever they are doing. That's our takeout point from the program today. We thank you for staying with us. My name is Sonny Duke Okosun. Bye for now.